بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، يا عباد الله، عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: خط لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خطا ثم قال: هذا سبيل الله، ثم خط خطوطا عن يمينه وعن شماله، ثم قال: هذه سبل متفرقة، على كل سبيل منها شيطان يدعو إليه، ثم قرأ: وأن هذا صراطي مستقيما فاتبعوه ولا تتبعوا سبلا فتفرق بكم عن سبيله. This hadith is a hadith that is tremendous. It's a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he explained to us a very important affair. And that is, as it comes on the authority of Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he drew for us a line. He drew a line. And he said, this is the way of Allah. This is the path of Allah. And then he drew lines off to its right and to its left. And then he said, these diverging paths, these paths that are going off separate from it, then at the head of each one of these paths is a shaitan that is calling to it. And then he recited Allahu Ta'ala's statement, what translated means, and verily this is my way, verily this is my straight path, therefore follow it, and do not follow the other paths, because they will separate you from his path. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he pointed out to us a number of things. From those things is that the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is one. The way of the truth, it is one. And this is why you find that when the straight path is referred to, is referred to in the singular. This is why when you find, for example, in the Quran, mention of the right way, it comes as nur, light. And when you find mention of the incorrect ways, then plurals are utilized. So for here, the sabil of Allah is one. But those incorrect paths, those incorrect ways, then they are referred to as subul, plural, because there are many. Whereas the right way is one, the wrong way is many. Likewise, when the wrong way is referred to, in contrast to nur, it is used the plural, dhulumat. The way of light, nur, is one. The wrong way, dhulumat, plural. Because the wrong ways are many. So this shows us that, contrary to popular belief, there are not different ways of following Islam. There are not different ways or different versions of Islam. There's only one Islam. There's only one way that is correct. And it is important for us to realize this, because we live in a time where there's a lot of ikhtilaf. And that ikhtilaf, of which it leads to separation, it leads to disunity, it leads to disharmony. So it is incumbent that we understand the reality of the situation that we are in, so that we can cling and stick to that which is correct. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in another hadith, hadith of Irbad bin Sariyah, he mentioned to us this same reality. Whoever from amongst you lives after me, he will see much differing, much differing. So what is the answer? The answer is what? To stick to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So thus he said, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. So it is upon you to stick to my sunnah and the sunnah of the righty guide of khulafa after me. Because the sunnah of the khulafa, it is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they did not contradict the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They did not come with something new, something foreign to that which is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But they were from the most adamant and from the most best followers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ala kulli hal, the way of truth is one, and the way of falsehood it is many. Also, that these separating paths, They have at the head of them shayateen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that ala kulli sabil minha, on every path from these separating paths from these subul, shaytan. There is a shaytan yad'u ilay. There's a shaytan who's calling to it. And we know from the way of shaytan is that he beautifies falsehood. Shaytan beautifies what is wrong. He makes it seem right. He gives to it a justification, making it seem okay, making the incorrect seem correct. This is the way of shaytan. So just because it has been beautified, just because its perception from the onlooker who was unknowing seems to be good, does not necessarily make it so. As they say, everything that shines is not gold. Naam. So it is incumbent that we have a methodology by way of which we are able to differentiate between the truth and the falsehood. What is that methodology? It is that medicine that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us in that aforementioned hadith, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي. So it is binding upon you to follow my sunnah. So whatever you may hear, whatever you may see, however it may be decorated by speech, asks a very important question. Does this coincide with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Does this coincide with the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa? Does this coincide with the way of the companions? Because if you bring something new that the companions were unaware of, then this is an indication that what you have brought is not right. What you have brought is not from Islam. Because what was Islam then is Islam now. What was not Islam then is not Islam now. So if it was foreign to the deen then that means because in reality it's foreign to the deen. Now, the next day, the next month, the next year, period, is foreign to the deen. Now, it is incumbent that we move upon this way and utilize this methodology so that we're able to navigate in these dark times and stick to that which is correct, and to sidestep those things that are incorrect. هذا أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولجميع المسلمين فاستغفروا فإنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. يا عباد الله, in light of what we just heard, if we want to truly be successful, then we have to seriously and earnestly strive to rectify ourselves. And if that rectification of ourselves and our attempts to rectify others renders us as the odd ones out and as strangers, well then good. Glad tidings to the strangers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he informed us in a famous hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Inna al-Islam bada'a ghariban," that Islam it began as strange. وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا, and it shall return to being strange. فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَاءِ, so glad tidings to the strangers. Glad tidings to the strangers. قَالُوا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَمَا الْغُرَبَاءِ, and the Sahaba, they said, "O Messenger of Allah, who are the strangers? Who are they?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he defined them. He pointed out some of their characteristics. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, in pointing out their key characteristic, الَّذِينَ يُصْلِحُونَ عِنْدَ فَسَادِ النَّاسِ, وَفِي الرِّوَايَةِ الَّذِينَ يُصْلِحُونَ عِنْدَ فَسَادِ النَّاسِ, أي يُصْلِحُونَ وَيَصْلِحُونَ, that they are the ones who يُصْلِحُونَ عِنْدَ فَسَادِ النَّاسِ, they are the ones. And when it comes with the dhamma, it means islah al-akhareen. It means to rectify others. That they are the ones who, when the people are corrupt, they strive to help others. They strive to rectify others and to rectify their situations. When they bring corruption, they try to call them to that which is rectification to that corruption. When they come with a misbelief, they try to call them to the right belief. When they come with a misunderstanding, they try to educate them to correct their understanding. When they come with evil, they try to prevent them and warn them from that evil. So on and so forth. This is a characteristic of those who are strange. And thus we will understand, and thus we can see why they will be considered as strange. The people are upon corruption, and they are upon uprightness, and they're calling people to also be upright. Don't give in to corruption, but be upright. This is an important characteristic. Why? Because we live in a time where it's not fashionable to do what is correct. It is not fashionable to be upright. Where it's not fashionable to be righteous. It's not fashionable to be pious. It's not fashionable to be shy. It's not fashionable to be a good Muslim. We live in a time where we're being called to just be a Muslim by name. Be a Muslim, but compromise on this, and then the list gets so long. It's okay, be a Muslim, but all the things is haram, it's okay, you do it. Things is halal, wajib, you can leave some things off, it's okay. No, it's not okay. It's not okay. It wasn't okay in the time of the Sahaba. It's not okay right now. It's not okay. But we live in a time where they say, no, it's okay. In the time of the Sahaba, the Sahabiyat, they used to cover. They would shield themselves by way of their clothes from the others. The companions were from the best of this nation. The Sahabiyat, they were from the best of this nation. When they prayed, the companions will stay in place so the female companions can get up and leave out the masjid. So there was no mixing. Even in the masjid, there was no mixing. Outside of the masjid, in the street, there was no mixing. They gave them time to exit the masjid and to go home. And even with that, how were they described when they were in their clothes? Were they described that you can see their shape? Were they described that their clothes beautified them, or their clothes draw attention to them? No. But they were described in the most modest of terms. But now they come now and they tell the Muslim women, it's okay. It's okay to put on this tight fitting clothes, and you call that your hijab. Hijab covers. Just because the skin is hidden, if it is tight, is that covering? Did not the Prophet ﷺ said that there are two types of people from the fire of which he has not seen? From them, those who are clothed yet still naked, because their clothes hide nothing, either because they are sheer and you can see through them, or because they are so tight fitting it leaves nothing for the imagination. Contemplate over these sports hijabs that they're trying to push on our women. These burkinis, as they call them, so on and so forth. Is that hijab? No way. But you see it on the billboards. You see it in the magazines. This is their marketing to our women. Be like this. Is that way okay? No, of course not. Because it didn't go in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So why would it be okay now? What was right then is what's right now. Now, and this is an example. This is an example. What this ala dhalik? And utilize that as a measuring stick, and yeah, make a comparison. Now, the point is that we are living in a time where we are being called to all types of facet. Person is shy, look down upon. What are you shy for? Be more bold. Subhanallah, in the Kufar school, do you know what they teach the children? When you speak to someone, look them in their face, look them in their eyes. They make no distinction. Whether it's a man or a woman, same sex, different sex, they make no distinction. When you speak to anyone, you look them in their face, look them in their eyes. So they're teaching our children what? Not to lower their gaze. Allah Ta'ala says for us to lower our gaze. If it's a woman, it's okay for us to stare her in her face, talk to her while we stare her in the face. It's okay for a woman to talk to a man, she's staring him in the face the whole time. That's okay. They say, this is good. These are from the etiquettes of good speaking and interaction when you meet people and so on and so forth. Does this coincide with the deen of al-Islam? No. If this is the opposite sex, lower your gaze. Don't stare them in the face, lower your gaze. Ala kulli hal, this is another example of how we're being called to all types of corruption. Where's the shyness in this type of situation? But shyness is from the deen. It is a branch of iman. Ya subhanallah. So those strangers, they rectify others. And also, yaslihun. And we mentioned this one second, even though in reality it is first, because it is obvious. Because الفاقد شيء لا يعطيه, the one who is deprived of something, he doesn't have the ability to give it. So in order to rectify others, you must have first what? Rectified yourself. So يصلحون means that they rectify themselves عند فساد الناس. When the people have become corrupt, they strive to rectify themselves. The people, they don't do what is correct, they strive to do what is correct. The people don't establish the obligatory affairs, they establish the obligatory affairs. The people don't do the voluntary affairs, they do the voluntary affairs. The people, they sleep at night, they don't get up and pray at night, they get up and they pray at night. So on and so forth. From those things which bring rectification to an individual, to themselves. They rectify themselves. It is incumbent that we strive to rectify ourselves and to better ourselves, because the only way of success is by being a stranger, is by rectifying yourself and rectifying others when the people have been given to corruption. We ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who hear a statement and then follow the best of it. وَأَنْ يَجْعَلْنَا مُبَارَكًا حَيْثُمَا كُنَّا وَأَنْ يَجْعَلْنَا مِنْ إِذَا أُعْتِيَ شَكَرٌ وَضُبَطُولِيَ صَبَرٌ وَإِذَا أَذْنَبَ اسْتَغْفَرٌ فَإِنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ ثَلَاثٌ عُنْوَانُ السَّعَادَةِ. هذا فأقيموا الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر.